Hi, I'm Julie Kavanaugh. I'm the coordinator of youth ministry here at St. Patrick, and I also coordinate the process of preparing candidates for confirmation. I welcome you to session one of your journey towards that sacrament. This is the sacrament that seals the deal. This is the sacrament that is going to get those gifts of the Spirit that are within you that you were given at your baptism, and we're just going to stir them up and get them so that we can set them loose out into the world. We are all created in God's image and likeness, and we are created for a mission. He has a mission for each one of us. Confirmation is about strengthening ourselves for that mission and about going forth and going out into the world and carrying out whatever that mission is that God has for us. I have six children. I have two that still live at home, four that are adults out on their own. And I have one that's actually going to be preparing for confirmation within this next year here. So I look forward to traveling this journey with your family as my family travels through it too. I'm going to give you a little glimpse as to what we're going to do throughout this video. We're going to kind of give you a glimpse as to what the process looks like to prepare for confirmation. We're going to give you an experience. Our process is all based on experiential learning, which and it's all hands-on. We are not sitting in classrooms. There is no book that I could send you home with and say, come back next fall and, you know, we'll go ahead and put that oil on your head and you'll be good to go, because it's about the experience. Confirmation is about a relationship. Faith is about a relationship. It's a relationship with a man, okay, with God. And this is the Holy Trinity, the part where we're really asking for that Holy Spirit that lives within each one of us just to be reignited and help set us on fire so we can go out into the world and do whatever that mission is that God has planned for us. So we're going to have an experience today. So I've asked you to have a piece of paper and a pen handy so that you can participate in this experience among some other experiences along the way. We'll have a time where we review all the forms, and I ask both parent and child be in the room for the entirety of it because the experience is going to require parent and child to work together on it. The forms, they're not all mom and dad's forms to fill out, kids. Hate to tell you this, but you know, it's time that you're becoming a full-fledged member of the Catholic Church, and you're going to have your own forms to fill out. So I want to be sure that you're aware of what those forms are and what you're going to need to do on that. Typically, we'd have a question and answer period. Unfortunately, in this kind of setting, you're just going to have to email me or call me with those, and I'll make sure that I get those answered. If there's some frequently asked questions, I don't mind putting a document together, putting it on the website, because other people might have the same questions. That's the best thing about a question and answer session is somebody's going to ask a question that a lot of other people in the room have. So I apologize for not being able to do that, but we will make sure that we answer any questions that you have. So there's some things that are important in preparation for confirmation. We use our hand, we call it the hand of hospitality, to let you know that what we're about. Okay, we are hospitable people. We are people that are welcoming, inviting. We are put on this earth to form relationships with others. So we want the confirmation process, pointer finger, we want it to be fun. That's our number one goal for this process. We want you to have fun, okay? And we're going to have lots of fun no matter what it looks like and how we have to meet. I guarantee that there's going to be some fun involved, okay? Your second finger, your tall finger that's the tallest on your hand, that represents food, okay? And we have some longer sessions that we have planned for you. We usually have meals at those. We're hoping we can still continue with that and we can gather for some meals because that's something that we do as Catholic and as Christians, as we gather around a table, okay? We gather around the Eucharistic table. And so we want to make sure that we are learning how to be that Christian hospitality. And so we're going to have some meals and some food. Ring finger, typically, you know, if you're married, you might have a wedding finger on your ring finger, that other finger there. That's going to represent our friends, okay? Friends are important, and we want you to journey through this process with friends. So you're going to see some old friends, and you are going to meet some new friends. And we hope that throughout the process that you just form some good friendships with people that have same morals and values and are working towards building themselves up in virtue, and that you can create some new friends throughout your life. And then last, we have our little pinky finger, which our smallest finger. And I a lot of times say teens are like two-year-olds. They're exerting their independence just in a different way. Terrible twos and terrible teens, parents, we know it, right? That's because this is your family, okay? And family, it's important. Pinky fingers are important. We use them for a lot of things, but they're little on our hand, right? Because at this point in our lives, our teens are kind of pushing away from us. They're trying to become their own person, and that's so important and so true. But, you know, family gives you a lot of foundation, and we want to make sure that you understand that the family's important there. And you see me using my thumb to touch some of these fingers, right? Because our thumb is our faith, okay? And our faith can touch all the things. It can touch our fun. It can touch our food. It can touch our friends. And it definitely touches our family. So we have this hand of hospitality, and that means because we are open to serve. And that's what confirmation, we have a service component in it, is because that's what we are called to do. We are called to serve and not be served. We are people of service, and that's how people will know. That's how we love. That's how we show our love for God, is when we serve one another. So we're going to start with a prayer, and I'm just going to put the prayer up on the screen, and we will read it together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Come, Spirit of God, grant us the power to be gentle, the strength to be forgiving, the patience to be understanding, the endurance to accept the consequences of holding on to what is right. Come, Spirit of God, help us to put our trust in the power of good to overcome evil, the power of love to overcome hatred. Come, Spirit of God, enlighten us with the vision to see and the faith to believe in a world free from violence, a new world where fear will no longer lead us to commit injustices, nor selfishness cause us to bring suffering to others. Come, Spirit of wisdom and love, source of all good, teach us your truth and guide our actions in your way of peace. Amen. All right, so I want to introduce you to the process. Okay, so teens, maybe you remember back in school, you were in religion class, or if you were one of my Genesis Logo students, you know, we had some formal, what we would call faith formation, where we're actually like sitting and learning. So whether we did that to receive our instruction, we want you to know that this is different. That learning doesn't always come out of a book, that it comes out of a life. And there's three testaments to our Bible. We have the Old Testament, we have the New Testament, and we have the U Testament. If you attended Father Tom's Mass this past Easter season, maybe you heard him talk about the 29th chapter of Acts, okay? And if you guys take out your Bible right now and you look for that 29th chapter, you're not going to find it. Because it's not written about. It's our lives. It's what we do, okay? The 29th chapter is what we're living right now. We're living the fifth gospel, the 29th chapter of Acts. We are living the life that Jesus has taught us to live. It's just not being documented the way it was in the Bible back then. So you'll notice our acronym for the process is GPS. It's a navigation system. We are all given our own GPS at birth. It's the breath of life, the God within, the Holy Spirit. We are guided by the Holy Spirit, powered by his breath, and sealed with his gifts. God has a plan for each and every one of us. God has designed a private road for each of us. No two lives are the same. Our paths may cross, we intersect, often travel alongside each other, but God has given us this navigation system, and we don't always keep it turned on. Through the GPS process, we're going to help the candidates discover their own GPS, turn it on, and learn how to use it throughout the rest of their lives. God created us to be the solution, and too often, we're part of the problem. So confirmation is about conversion, not just information. The process is designed to awaken the faith of the candidate. We're not just gathered to pass along information. We gather to practice our faith. Christianity is not about becoming a nice person. It's about becoming a new person, the one God intended you to be. One of the great misunderstandings about Christianity in the modern age is that it's about behavior modification, or just general human qualities. Christianity is truly death to pride, selfishness, and the world. It's becoming a little Christ, living a selfless way, living for others. The longest distance we're ever going to have to travel is from our head to our heart. And I think we all have a little better understanding about what this means. We've all gone through our own little desert wandering. Might have been from the bedroom to the kitchen. We've also all gone through an exodus. An exile. We're ready to return, but we want to return restored. So we want to figure out, what is this going to look like? What does the new future have in store for us? So we're going to provide experiences to practice things that you already know. You already have the knowledge. If you don't use it, you'll lose it. We're going to apply what we've learned about religion and faith. The process is truly transformative. It's restorative. We're going to become those people that God intended us to be. Faith formation is living with the community, it's learning with the community, it is praying with the community, and it is serving with the community. And we're looking forward to soon gathering as that community that God has created us to be. So at this point, I'm going to introduce you to a couple of my friends. The process involves what we call facilitators. We have both teen facilitators, they're peer mentors. We also have some adult facilitators. They're here for basically like crowd control, task management, and timekeeper. And we break into small groups. And so if we're not sure what the fall looks like, these small groups could possibly be as an online session. But I want you to meet a couple of facilitators that will be working with you throughout the process next fall. And maybe you have some older brothers and sisters that have done this in the past or would like to join us this time. Parents, this is where you come in. This is where you can possibly come in and help and be an adult facilitator. We would never put you in the same small group as your child, but you'd get to learn the same information and helping others grow in their faith. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to a couple of our peer ministers.
Hi, my name is Natalie Vogt. I'm finishing up my freshman year at Wild Lake Northern, and I just made my confirmation last fall. At first, when I started going, it felt really forced and it felt like something I just had to go to every week. But then I started taking it seriously and I really enjoyed going and I looked forward to going every week. The process really just changed my perspective. It brought me closer to God than I ever have been, and I feel like it really changed me for the better. I met so many new friends. It also helped me to strengthen myself for my spiritual life. And it helped me to realize that confirmation is all about accepting responsibility for your faith. So I hope you have as much fun and enjoy it as much as I did.
Hi, my name is Jacob Christensen, and this will be my third year facilitating confirmation for St. Pat's. The reason why I come back each year is because I truly see a positive change happening in the group of people that come through this program. I see people enter, I see people grow as they go through the program, and I see people come out new and improved versions of themselves. So that's why I come back to facilitate.
Hello, I am Bruce Beans. My wife is a teacher here at St. Patrick, Dawn Beans. I was invited to help facilitate with confirmation about 6 years ago as an adult facilitator. But many years before that, I taught my own children confirmation. It was a classroom setting with homework and reading and hours of lectures. This program is much different. This confirmation program does have lecturing. However, this program encourages candidates to interact with each other and grow in their faith and focus on their faith. It's a journey of activities and interacting with others in the class, other teen facilitators, as well as the whole group. Sharing ideas and experiences and points of view and their feelings. Through my experience here, helping with confirmation for this time, I have grown a lot in my own faith. And we truly hope everyone grows and blossoms into strong, confident Catholic Christians for life. Thank you.
So you've heard me say the word experience, okay? It's experiential learning. This is why we can't send you home with a book. This is why we're gonna have to think things a little different to navigate this new normal. Everything we do is part of the message. We don't like to call it a program, we like to call it a process. And because of that, there's no way to make up a missed session. It's an experience. So just please make this a priority next year. You know, a lot of things have been wiped off our calendar. Our calendars are pretty free, and it's up to us to decide how to refill them. What are we going to add back into our life, and what are we going to just let go that was not life-giving, that was not really helping us become the people that God wants us to be? So think of that as you're starting to look at your fall calendar and how you want to fill it up with those activities that you so miss. Think about just giving this year, this new normal year, maybe to God. Give it to God. See what God will return to you. We know God returns things to people tenfold. So I just challenge you to give this this priority. Facilitators are going to journey with the candidates. It's about the relationships, and that's why we are so hoping that we can gather once again in face-to-face, because that's where the real growing in faith happens. We're going to practice the skills of the sacraments, the Beatitudes, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and we'll get to experience the fruits that they bear. So there was a calendar sheet schedule of how we plan to carry out this year. Might have to make some adjustments, so please be patient, but we're hoping that we can still keep true to the sacraments, the Beatitudes, and the gifts of the Spirit, because those really are how Jesus showed us the way, how he showed us what what the beatitude is, the happiness that he wants for us if we follow those beatitudes. The sacraments are how we can experience his presence, and we're going to learn how we can experience his presence in the everyday through those sacraments. And eventually we'll be able to get to see the fruit that they bear that we find in the book of Galatians, chapter 5. So confirmation is a choice. God has already chosen you. But the big thing is, have you chosen God? So I know some of you teens are here only because your parents are making you sit in front of the screen, or, you know, it's because what you're supposed to do at this age and this time in your life. But as you can see from the words of our facilitators that gave witness to this experience, the consequences of this process are powerful. You'll have a sense of belonging. You're going to have a renewed awareness that you can use your power of choice over everything in your day. You're going to be empowered. You're going to have a renewed appreciation of your ability to affect and change your life and the lives of others. I promise that if you enter this process with an open mind, you will choose to be confirmed, because it truly is your choice. It's your parents' responsibility to bring you to preparation, to prepare you for the sacrament. They made this covenant vow with God at your baptism. They said they were going to raise you in the faith, and this is their last responsibility for you. And then after this, your faith life is yours. Your faith journey is yours. It is yours to grow. It is yours to develop. So our process here is about the relationships. It's about learning the skills of loving. It's going to be some peer-to-peer ministry. We find that's the key to success for it. The facilitators that we have are going to journey with you. They're going to help make it easy. They are not teachers. They are growing in faith right alongside you. It's about becoming a disciple. What does that look like in the year 2020 and 2021? And there's two important questions that I'm asking you, and you need to ask yourself. Why are you here? Why do you want to be confirmed? Everything we do has a purpose, and we should know what that purpose is. So I want you to pray about those questions, think about those questions, ponder those questions as you're preparing for confirmation, as we go through the sessions. Be open. So typically at this point of our session, I would play a song and I'd ask you to mingle around and meet new people and end up with somebody that maybe you don't know too well. And the reason being, it's time for an experience. So this experience you're going to get to have with your son or daughter, you're going to get to have this with mom or dad. But it's important because you're going to discover something that maybe you think you know this person sitting in the room with you, but you're going to discover something new about them through this experience. So at this time, I'm going to ask you each to take something that maybe you have on your person, or if you're in your home, pause the video for a second and find something that maybe it's in your room or something. So I'm gonna give you an example. So I have, like, if I was to pull something off my person, it would be this cross necklace here. And the reason, it's gonna be something that tells other people more about who you are, not just like the superficial about you, because a lot of people know about people. You guys all have your social media and you know a lot about a lot of people. You follow a lot of people, or they follow you or whatever, and you see a lot of about people, but you don't really truly know who they are. So there's things that we have that we either carry or maybe we keep in our room that would tell a story and tell somebody else something special about us. So I'm going to use my necklace, for example. So this necklace here actually got for my first communion back, and I'll just tell you, it was the 70s. I got this from my godparents. Okay, I have a very special relationship with my godparents. I always wanted to grow up to be a godparent like my godparents, because they really followed me along my life journey. They really helped me through my younger years. It was an aunt and uncle, one of my mother's closest brother and sister-in-laws, and they just really helped develop me, and they're part of who I am because of their influence on my life. Another thing, so like, let's say I wasn't to pull something, I didn't have anything on my person, I happened to not being wearing the necklace today, I would have gone to my bedroom and I would have gone to tell the same story about my godparents. This is actually the little First Communion statue that they had given me at my First Communion. And I've kept it all these years. I keep it on a little bookshelf next to a picture of them from their 50th wedding anniversary. And they're just very, I have a very special relationship with them. They just really helped form who I am in terms of my faith journey and my faith life. They had a strong impact on my faith journey. So I want you at this time to either pull something out of your pocket, maybe your purse. Just don't go in the kitchen drunk drawer. No. So something out of your bedroom. Just find something. And then I want you to pause the video for a second. Take some time and share with one another what this is and what's the story behind it. This is how we get to know each other better. Okay, so I'm going to welcome you back. So this is an experience about getting to know you, not just knowing about you. So if we would have done this in a room with people maybe that you didn't know, you would have come across somebody that you would have gotten to know a little bit better throughout this exercise here. So discipleship is an opportunity to encounter Jesus, to join him in his game, and to walk alongside him. It's not an opportunity to just hear about Jesus. You know, we hear about Jesus a lot. We come to Mass, we hear about Jesus. Maybe in your religion classes or your Genesis Logos, you heard things about Jesus. But confirmation, we really want you through getting to learn how to be a disciple, we want you to encounter Jesus. We want you to share in some experiences with him. We all have a built-in desire for connectedness, and I think that's what's been so hard about these past few months, that we've been separated. We've been physically separated from people that we love, you know, friends that we desire to share time with. We also live in a culture that promotes individualism. It's really the quality of our relationships and not the number of our relationships that matter. And we've so realized that because we have a lot of friends out there, but we haven't been able to have that quality time with them. And so I think we all have that hunger, and we can sort of get that now. We get the fact that we need to be connected to each other. Discipleship is all about making connections. Jesus was the ultimate gatherer. We know from our stories in the Bible how he gathered people. He sent his disciples out in pairs. To be a disciple is to be a discipler, one who makes more disciples. We just heard that in our Great Commission from our last Sunday of our Easter season. We heard that we are to go out and make more disciples. And that's why we ask for works of mercy hours during our preparation for confirmation. Now, I know you're already having questions like 10 hours. How are we going to possibly get 10 hours the way the world looks today? I'm not going to say right now that we are going to make adjustments to that, because it's very doable the old way. And so I'm thinking that if things turn around a little bit, it's going to be very doable the new way. But if we have to make changes, we have to make changes. But those mercy hours are not meant to be like a job to do. They're meant to help train us into that life of service that God is calling each one of us. He's calling us to serve and not be served. And we need to be intentional disciples. So we need to make intentional plans to go out and do things that are going to illustrate our discipleship to others. So we're going to ask you to have some, so there's a service hour component. We're going to ask you to do some works of mercy. We've made adjustments for some of the teens that have been preparing for confirmation for this past spring. Had to make some adjustments for different kinds of mercy hours that they could do that don't involve physical contact. So we're going to, you know, we'll think outside of the box, but we will definitely have a service component, because confirmation is about service to others. Being a full-fledged Catholic is about service to others. All these ministries, there was so much service going on to prepare our parish for the reopening that we just had. So we need to have that service component. Jesus invested his time and energy in groups of people. Christianity is communal. Discipleship brings us in closer connection to others. And we come together as imperfect people. We can humble ourselves. Our salvation is not going to be found in isolation. So at this time, I'm going to ask you two important questions. Why are you here? And you're probably thinking, because my mom's making me watch this video right now. No, but why are you here? Why do you want to be confirmed? You know, everything that we do in life should have a purpose. We should know the why behind why we're doing what we're doing. So take a minute to think, why do you want to be confirmed? And if your answer you feel is like, I'm not sure, that's okay, because that's what this process is. It's going to help you discover why. Why do you want to be confirmed? You don't have to know the exact answer right now, but you do have to be asking the question. And hopefully when we get to the end, you'll be able to say that yes to discipleship, just the way Mary said yes to God when he asked her to be the mother of God. So you have that piece of paper and your pen, and you're wondering, what am I going to do with it? This time I want you to take and just draw a line down the center. I don't care which way you hold the paper, just draw a line down the center. And on one half, I want you to put the word get, G-E-T. All right. What do you want to get from this process of preparing for confirmation? I want you to discuss, parents, discuss with your child, discuss with your parents. What do you want to get? So pause the video for a second. Make a laundry list, you know, at least a half a dozen things about what do you want to get from the process of preparing for confirmation. Okay, so look that side over, and then on the other side, write the word give, G-I-V-E, write give on the other side. And then discuss with each other, what are you willing to give? So parent, what are you willing to give your teen to help them through this process? And then teen, what are you willing to give to this process in order to get the most out of it? So what are you willing to give? There's a saying that the more you give, the more you get. It's in our giving that we receive. So we want to make sure that we give something to this process too. So go ahead and pause for a minute, make a list of the gives. All right, so hopefully you came up with some creative things that you are willing to give to this process in order to get those things on the other side of the list. It really boils down to one get and one give. All we need to get is God's grace, and all we need to give is the desire to be confirmed. But it has to be true, genuine, authentic desire. God knows when we are giving this. The confirmation process is going to satisfy all those needs and wants, all those gets that you have on your get list. It's a life-changing opportunity for each person involved. But the last thing I want to see is the teens completing the sacraments of initiation and missing the truth. But in order to give and get, we need to get rid of some of our butts.
I got a big butt. It's gigantic, if I'm gonna be blunt about it. And you know what? The funny thing is, I got several big butts. And before you discard me or wince at the disgusting notion of that, I'm gonna go out on a limb here and suggest that possibly you have at least one big butt as well. Yeah, you like that? Hurts a little, huh? Let me tell you something. Let me just tell you something, okay? Everybody we know has a big butt. And more often than not, it's the thing that actually gets in the way of us living a consistent life for Jesus. Yeah, I think you know what I'm talking about. I'm going to expound a little bit, okay? See if you can recognize some of these butts. But I have to work more. But my favorite TV show is on. But my kids have practice. But I got to tweet something. But it's such a beautiful day. But I'm just not in the mood. But I deserve a break today. You see, everything kind of interferes with my life of just living an authentic life for God, okay? And more often than not, it always has something to do with some sort of butt, okay? Even the littlest of butt can distract me. It really can. The littlest butt can make me think, I'm not going to pray today. I'm not going to think about it today. I'm not going to deny myself. I'm not going to read the Bible, blah, blah, blah. Whatever God asks me to do, I seem to have a butt for it and get away, okay? And the most horrendously big butt of all time is the butt that gets in the way of me just hanging out with God and reading His Word. It's true. Think about it. All the times you're about to open that, and all of a sudden a big giant butt gets in the way. A butt. Much like one of these. But I got a farm bill, but I'm tired, but the game's over, but I read last Tuesday, but I gotta check Facebook, but I don't like Leviticus, but it's too hot in here, but I just don't like books, but I don't understand it, but it's boring. But what does that have to do with me in the 21st century? Those are some ugly butts, people. Let's just call them what they are. Ugly. Ugly butts. Okay? And there's a lot more to them, sad but true. Here's a list, although not exhaustive, of some of the most popular butts known to mankind. But I don't have enough money yet. But others will think that I'm a nerd if I carry the Bible. But they won't like me if I talk about Jesus. But I don't know if God will do what I ask. But I just can't get motivated. But I'm afraid. But I don't have all the answers. But the small group is the same night as Monday Night Football. But can I just let my life speak for itself? But I'm not happy. But that's not my gift. But that's the pastor's job. But I don't know how to pray. But I can't believe that. But I don't know where to start. But everybody else is having fun. Butts abound, friend. But. Here a butt, there a butt. Everywhere, a butt. Okay? And the most overused butt of all time, but I just don't have enough time. Really? Oh, come on. We have a lot of butts. God has given us a real simple word. Okay? If we learn it, and we share it, and we teach it, and we live by it, then see, God gets glorified, people benefit, and then we get blessed. That's why we do what we do. That's the why behind the butt. Okay? And ultimately, that's the whole point I'm trying to make here, my fellow butt lovers, is if your butt is bigger than your why, then your butt's too big. Okay, it's time to, metaphorically speaking, snap into a Slim Jim. Okay, let's slap on some spiritual shape-ups and hit the road a little bit so we can just manage the butts a little bit. That's all we're trying to do. That's what we're talking about. Let's minimize the excuses. Let's shrink the butts. Shrink the butts. Say it with me. Shrink the butts. That's what we need to do. And you and I can do that together. We can conquer this. You and I can do it if we start today, okay? I know we can. Let's just do it. No ifs, ands, or... Yeah. I think you get it.
So every journey towards one thing is a journey away from something else. So if we are journeying towards God, there are things that we are going to be journeying away from. Saying yes to one thing means that we're saying no to another. So like I said, we've all had that calendar clearing moment. I mean, everybody's experienced it on the face of the earth. We've been under a pandemic. We've had to cancel plans for so many things. I had a high school graduate this year. Extremely upsetting. You know, you guys are mostly eighth graders and you've had your farewell parties, your Cedar Point trips, maybe your Washington, D.C. trip, all canceled. So we know what it's like, what it feels like to have our calendars cleared, but we can do it and we can survive. It's okay. Now it's time to figure out, like, how are we going to add back things into our life and what was really important and what wasn't important. So I think this is just a wonderful time to be preparing for confirmation as we begin to journey into the new normal, as we begin to start having things enter back into our life. What was life giving? What do we want back? And what was not pleasing to God, and what do we want to get rid of? So this all gives us a wonderful opportunity to do this. We can do this. We know we can. We've done it. So what are we willing to clear off our calendars to make more room for God? So at this point, I'm going to kind of go through some of the forms that we have. So if you have your packet handy, fine. If not, I'm going to be showing them up on the screen, so you'll get to see what each each page is, so that you can eventually get those filled out, and we will turn those in when we meet for session two.
Help! I need somebody. Help! Not just anybody. Help! You know I need someone. Help!
Okay, now that I've got your attention, I'm speaking to you, parents. Are you in? Would you like to be involved in the process? I definitely need some adult facilitators, especially not knowing what the future is bringing for us. Or maybe you have an older sibling at home that's been through the process before and is willing to get some of their own community service hours by helping with the confirmation process. Can you help organize a meal for one of our extended sessions? We have the two extended sessions, either number two or number four or five, depending on the track. Or are you able just to send in some snack donations to help us out there with water and chips? Most importantly, are you willing to make this a priority on your calendar in the fall? At this time, before I get into all the paperwork, I want to explain a little bit about our session four or five. It is an extended session because we watch an hour-long video. It's called Sex Has a Price Tag. It's done by Pam Stenzel, who is a Catholic youth speaker. The content of it is our Catholic Church teaching on sexuality. We deal with the sacrament marriage and blessed are the pure at heart for our beatitude. And we focus on the sacrament of marriage mainly from a friendship point of view and forming good friendships. So we talk a lot about friendship, dating, sexuality, conflict resolution, all during that session. So at this time, I just want to show you a short snippet of the Pam Stenzel movie. The candidates will watch it in their entirety at that session. You are welcome to preview it in advance. Most of it is offered on YouTube. I can also bring you in and show the video at the church. We only have one DVD, so I don't let it leave the building, but we can arrange for a preview of the video if you'd like to see it in its entirety.
I came tonight so that none of you would be able to leave this auditorium and ever again be able to say to a physician, to a counselor, to your future husband or wife, "Nobody told me. I didn't know." If you have sex outside of a permanent marriage relationship, you will pay. There's a cost. No one has ever had sex outside of that context and not paid, and the question we gotta ask tonight is this: what is the cost, and is it worth it?
I travel all over the United States and internationally, speaking to about 250,000 teenagers a year. Every year, and have learned a tremendous amount from the students that I've spoken to. Before I started speaking and traveling full time, I spent 9 years counseling in crisis pregnancy centers in Chicago and in Minneapolis, St. Paul. And for 9 years, I would have girls in my office every day saying, "Pam, I didn't know." And if somebody would have told me that this was going to be the result of the choice I was making, I'd have made a different choice. No one told me. I began to ask these girls in my office, what could we have said? What could someone have said to you before you made your choice that might have helped you to have made a better choice? And after 9 years, I realized that there were a lot of students out there making decisions about sex, having absolutely no idea what the consequence of that choice would be. It's what we're going to talk about today. I want you to understand that I didn't come today to decide for you what you're going to do about sex. That is not why I'm here. I can't make this choice for you. Don't intend to. Can't go on your dates with you. I don't have time. Okay? I mean, I can't choose for you. No matter how much we would wish that we could put you in a box, lock it, feed you through a window till you're 24, we can't. All we can do is love you, tell you the truth, hope you make good choices. My goal today isn't to decide for you what you're going to do. You can do whatever you want. My goal is that none of you would be able to leave here and ever again have to say to a physician, to a counselor, to your future husband or wife, nobody told me. I didn't know. Today you're going to be told. What you choose to do when you walk out of here is up to you. I get to start today the way I can't typically start in public school settings, and that's why it's so wonderful to be in parochial schools and be able to start this way. Students, God created sex. It's awesome. It's not a terrible thing we can't talk about at Catholic school. God created sex. That's right. Now listen. Listen up. God wants you to have great sex. He does. This is not about wrecking your fun. Now listen, you guys laugh at that, and I am going to prove it to you by the end of this hour, so you have to pay very close attention, because I'm going to have to talk to you about this again. God created sex. It was His idea, not yours. But God created sex with boundaries. And when sex happens within boundaries, it's awesome. When it happens outside of boundaries, it's horribly, horribly destructive. Help me out. What is the boundary or the context for which God created sex? Marriage. There's the right answer.
So this movie is an hour long. It is the quietest hour we will ever have at confirmation preparation. She's a very engaging speaker. She will give us a faith-based perspective on sex and marriage. It goes into much more than just the fear of pregnancy. It discusses all the health risks involved for both boys and girls. And it's way better, parents, to have this conversation with your teen on a Saturday or Sunday morning over a bowl of cornflakes than to be making these decisions in the backseat of somebody's car on Saturday night at 10 p.m. So this will open up that door for you to have those discussions. Maybe I opened up the door today just showing the little snippet of the video. But it's better that they hear it from you than to hear it from the world and their peers that maybe don't have a faith life. Okay, now for the forms explanation. You guys should have all gotten a packet with a cover sheet like this on it. The only thing that you really need to look at is the bottom part where the baptismal certificate is required. So please make sure that you make a copy of that. I'm going to give you my cell phone number in the email so you can even text me a picture of it. If you want to do it that way, you can scan it in your computer and email it to me. However you'd like to get that to us, we do need a baptismal certificate to start the preparation process. Registration's online. I have given you the link to that. It's also now on the website. I show you the draft schedules. Like I said, subject to change. We don't know what the future looks like. This is what we're hoping it looks like. If not, I am willing to make adjustments and figure this out. Just be patient with me. We've got some plans B and C in the dream and planning stages, but we're hoping that we don't have to execute those and that we can go with our plan A. But the thing is that you will pick track one or two and stick with it. Take into account any extracurricular activities that your child might be involved in, if they're involved in a sports, you know, what that season might look like next year. Also take into consideration that saying yes to one thing means saying no to another. So I'm just saying you're going to miss things. There are going to be things that you're going to miss for confirmation process. Just like anything that's important to you, you just have to say no to other things to make it work. So we don't want to let the world control our calendar. We want to have God control our calendar. And so make this important this year. Let God work through you. You'll notice sessions 2 and either 4 or 5 are extended sessions. All the sessions are for the candidates only, except that session 4 or 5, depending on which track you're in, the sponsor candidate session would be a meeting where the sponsor would come with the candidate. It's an opportunity for them to start the mentoring relationship. We do some activities together. If they choose a sponsor that is not in town, they just need to bring another partner with them for the activities that can relay the information to their sponsor. And then I also will be sending email information that can be conveyed to the sponsor that way. The right of choice and election, you'll see that on one of the weekends. You just come to whatever mass. You don't have to specifically come to a particular mass, just either the 5, 8, 10, or 12. I'll be there at all masses conferring this right. So just come to the whatever mass you normally come to. The confirmation dates will be emailed to you as soon as we get the go-ahead that we can start scheduling those. We pick, we tell them when you are going to be fully prepared, and then the bishop actually picks the date for us. So we don't have a lot of control over that, only that we'll know that it will take place after we are certain that you will be prepared. So be patient with that. Typically, it's usually been, you know, the weekend maybe before Thanksgiving in the fall, and in the spring, it doesn't interfere with our First Communion weekend. It's usually either Mother's Day weekend or maybe the weekend after that, just so you have a kind of an idea. But like I said, we don't know what the future is going to bring. We don't know how that's going to change, so just be open. Each session focuses on a sacrament, a beatitude, and the gift of the Spirit. You can see that from the calendar, so you'll kind of know what we're talking about at each session if you look at those draft calendars. The next page is that bright pink one. Like I said, if you don't have these this packet, don't worry about it. This gives you a glimpse at what it looks like. We will get you a packet. Any information that you do need to turn in, I will email you copies. We gave the paperwork out because there's a lot of things that need to be turned in for different parts of the process. And we just wanted to make sure that you had hard copies of everything and that you weren't killing your own printer. But if there's something that I need, I will email it to you. So anyway, that pink page is what Works of Mercy Hours looked like before the new normal. So this will be updated as we have other opportunities that come about. But this just gives you an idea of the kind of things that we're looking for. They are done at the parish, at the parish community. This is kind of like our opportunity. You know, at home, maybe we have our kids do chores before they get a real job. So it gives them kind of a safe environment to learn and to grow and to practice. And so we are going to practice being Catholics. And so we're going to practice in our faith community. There are so many things that are done by volunteers in our church environment. And so it's time that our new full-fledged Catholic members, our soon-to-be confirmed Catholics, learn what all there is that makes this church work. I mean, there's tons of volunteer opportunities. And so we just want them to be aware that there's a place for them. There's something for each one of us to do to contribute towards our parish home. So that gives you an idea there what that looks like. The pink sheet is that help that I cried out for. I'm just like some questionnaire, just some questions for the parents as to, so I get a better idea of what you're looking for from us. And then also adult participation at the bottom there. Like I said, I'm going to need adult facilitators, whether we are at the church or whether we have to meet in small groups in like a Zoom type session setting or something like that. I do need an adult in each space. For crowd control, task management, timekeeper, keep the kids focused. We do have the peer ministers, the teen facilitators that do an awesome job of actually running the small group sessions and conveying the information that's going to be discussed and the experiences that are going to be experienced during those. But I do need parents, so feel free to let me know if you're willing to help out there. The next kind of gold form is the media consent form. Pictures that we take might be posted in the bulletin, might be on our bulletin board in the hallway over by the gym. We do put slide presentations together that we show at sessions. We show it at the candidate sponsor session. We show one. We show one at the pre-retreat meeting for the parents. We use a family slideshow at the retreat. And then at the final celebration, when we have the confirmation, we might have a reception afterwards where we would have a slideshow there. So it's not for public viewing, but we do need you guys to consent that it's okay that we are taking pictures of your kids and they will be used within the parish grounds. The next one is a gray form. It is the field trip participation. This is for, depending on which season, in the fall we have an opportunity to go to a Come Encounter Christ. In the spring we have an opportunity to go to what's called Rise. If those actually can take place, we'll need that field trip participation slip for that. And in addition to the next page, which is the Wald Lake Outdoor Education Center, form, and that just is a waiver release liability. We also take that with us so we have contact information in case there is ever an emergency or something that we would contact parents. The only time I've ever had to use that is about a year ago. We had the power go out while we were at the Waldeck Outdoor Education Center, and we had to cut our retreat a little bit early on the second day, and so we had to call parents to let them know what time pickup would be. Next, we have sponsor. Okay, teens, if you tuned out, tune back in. Sponsor form. This is for you. This is your homework, okay? You are to choose a sponsor. They must be a confirmed Catholic adult at least 16 years of or older. I think it is wise to pick an adult, not necessarily just an older sibling or cousin or something, because they're convenient. I think it's really good to establish more adult mentors in the life of a teen, especially people of faith. So if you can find somebody that is a good role model for you, a good mentor, somebody who you can easily talk to, or that you would like to develop a better relationship with, I would choose somebody like that for your confirmation sponsor. Should be somebody you look up to. So it gives you some kind of some guidelines about choosing the sponsor at the bottom there. I'll let you read through that on your own. If you have any questions, feel free to call me or email me, let me know. But this form will be, you'll need to have it when we start up, whether you start in August or January. This form will need to be filled out. I need to know who your sponsor is, and you'll be giving them an invitation to come to that sponsor candidate session. So make sure before you begin the preparation process with session two that you have chosen your sponsor. And give it some thought. Pick somebody that you really would like to have this mentor relationship with. The next form, kind of a buff colored is or ivory, is choosing a confirmation name. Again, it gives you a description on why we kind of choose a name. This represents that conversion, that process of becoming the person who God created you to be. Your parents, you know, if you don't know why your name was chosen for you, this is a good time to discuss when this video ends as to why they chose that name for you. And so it's an opportunity for you to learn about that and then to pick your own name. And it could be a saint's name. It could be a name of somebody you admire, you aspire to be. Just make sure that you give it some thought, because this is going to be the name. We're not going to call you this name, you know, from this day forward, but it's a name that's going to represent this time in your life when you've made that conversion into, you know, choosing the Catholic faith for yourself. So take some thought and some prayer into choosing your confirmation name. And then there's just like a short little report, write a few sentences about, you know, why you chose this, what inspires you about this person or this saint. And write that at the bottom there as with your saint's name. And that we need by session 9, or actually that one's by the retreat. We do something with the confirmation names at our retreat, so you'll need to know what your name is before you go on retreat. Next is the green form, which is your works of mercy log sheet, where you're gonna log your hours. And like I said, if we have to make adjustments, just be patient, let me figure this out, but I do have some opportunities where we can do works of mercy, spiritual works of mercy. You'll learn the difference between spiritual and corporal works of mercy, and where we can do some spiritual works of mercy and accomplish the tasks that we need to do. Confirmation is about going forth and living that life of service. You know, people know we are Christian by the way we love, and the way we love is that we do the works of God, which is the works of mercy. So there's the sheet there. At the end, you're going to write a short reflection about your time. You're going to find that, you know, works of mercy isn't necessarily work. It can be fun. It can be uplifting. It can be rewarding. So you'll get to discover all that as you go through works of mercy. And then finally, the last sheet is the confirmation registration sheet. It has been put all online. And if you haven't done it yet, you can do it at the end of this video, Mom or Dad. Fill that out. One thing on there is where it says parents' email. If you're filling out the hard form, I believe on the online form we have the option for both mom and dad email. Give us the email that you are going to read. That is how we communicate. That's how we're going to get a hold of you and let you know what's going on, let you know if there's something missing that we need. We tend to just use emails. It's a lot easier to blast it out to, you know, 50, 60 people at a time, do it via email than for me to make phone calls. So make sure it's a good email, something that you regularly look at. And then also, if there's multiple emails, if both mom and dad need the information, please make sure that I have both. And I will be sending out, once we start collecting registrations and things like that over the summer, I will be sending out emails with opportunities for works of mercy. So if you don't hear from me, let's say by mid-July, make sure that you shoot me an email and make sure that the email I have is good. Okay, so our St. Patrick Parish mission statement. As a confirmed Catholic, we are all called to live out this mission. This is the mission that God has entrusted to us from that great commission to go out and make more disciples and to spread the good news. So our mission statement goes like this. We, the St. Patrick Parish of White Lake, are a Catholic faith community that celebrates life in Christ. As we are nourished and led by the Holy Spirit, our common baptismal mission is to evangelize, to proclaim, and to teach the Word of God, to praise and to worship God in word and sacrament, and to live His Word through loving service to all people. On this active faith journey, we are called to be disciples who affirm, heal, forgive, in the love of Christ. Amen. So this is what you are called to be as a confirmed Catholic. So be looking at this mission statement and know that you are owning it. When you say yes to confirmation and yes to discipleship, you are saying yes to our mission of carrying on God's mission. So our lives, they tell a story. We might be the only Bible that some people read. This process of preparing for confirmation helps us to surrender to the way of Jesus by becoming more like him, by properly living and telling his story. He was meek and he was lowly. He was humble and he was compassionate. He was full of grace and full of the truth, the epitome of sacrificial love. He was forgiving towards all, and he welcomed the most repugnant among us. He was filled with the Spirit that gives love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And we're going to spend the next 9 sessions, because you're coming to the completion of session 1, we're going to learn how to tell this story, and we're going to learn how to live the gospel, because that's how we tell the story. We tell the story with our words and our actions and how we live our life. That's how people are going to get to know God, is by getting to know us, because God lives within each one of us. We have that Holy Spirit dwelling within, and that's who we want to let others know and others get to know God through us. So typically at this point, we'd have some questions and answers. Like I said, feel free to email them to me. We have a short little 13-minute film we show here at the end about our call to discipleship, about how we are chosen. We are already chosen, you know, but the big question is, do we choose God? So I ask you at the end of the video segment that's coming up here that you go ahead and click on the register now form, and fill that out. And we will be in touch with you and hopefully see some of you in August, and the rest of you will meet up in January. Thanks for taking your time today to learn how to properly register and get ready for confirmation.
I want to be the kind of person who does the right thing. And I don't just mean the big things, where right and wrong are obvious and easy, but I mean the small things, the subtle, unnoticed things, like helping my neighbor when she's shoveling a driveway. You know, what I do when no one's watching. Because it's so easy to let those small things slip away. And it's those endless choices that we make every day that shape us and the kinds of people that we are. But this has started to change for me recently because I've started to believe different things about myself. A friend of mine gave me insight into the story about Jesus and his disciples that I'd heard before, but it's just taken on whole new meaning. Jesus' disciples are in a boat. And it's the middle of the night, and they're trying to get across the lake, and the wind is blowing, and it's getting choppy, and Jesus comes walking out to them on the water. Now they think he's a ghost. So they're like, Jesus, is it you? And he says, yes. And one of them, Peter, gets out of the boat and starts walking on the water towards Jesus. What is Peter thinking? And why does he believe that he can walk on water? Now, what I've come to realize is the story makes way more sense if you understand the background. Jesus is a Jewish rabbi with Jewish disciples living in a first century Jewish world. Now, Jesus grew up in a region called the Galilee, and the Jewish people in the Galilee believed that God had spoken to Moses, one of their great historical leaders, and had given him the first five books of the Bible. They called these first five books the Torah. Torah means like teaching or instructions or simply the way. And so Torah was the center, the foundation of their lives, and it was the focus of their educational system. So most Jewish boys or girls around the age of six would go to school for the first time to learn the Torah. It'd probably be held in the local synagogue and be taught by a local Torah teacher who was a rabbi. This first level of education was called Beit Sefer and lasted until the kid was around 10 years old. In Beit Sefer, most kids would memorize the Torah and by the age of 10 have the Torah by heart, every word, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, memorized. Now, by the end of Beit Sefer, which would be around 10 years of age, most kids were no longer going to school. They were learning the family trade, learning the family business, learning how to manage a household. But the best of the best would keep going. They would continue their education into the next level, which was called Beit Talmud. In Beit Talmud, the best of the best who were still going on, the ones with the most natural ability, would memorize the rest of the Hebrew scriptures. Genesis through Malachi, memorize. Now, by the end of Beit Talmud, 14, 15, most kids are learning the family business, learning the family trade, apprenticing with their parents. But the best of the best of the best would continue on to the next level of education, which was called Beit Midrash. And they'd go to a rabbi and they'd apply to that rabbi to become one of that rabbi's disciples. Now, when we use the word disciple, we often mean student, but we generally mean somebody who knows what the teacher knows. But a disciple is something far deeper. A disciple just doesn't want to know what the rabbi knows. A disciple wants to be like the rabbi and wants to learn to do what the rabbi does. Now, rabbis differed in how they interpreted the Torah. They would take like a verse or a command, and one rabbi might say, well, this is what it means to follow this verse or to do this command of God. But another rabbi might say, no, I think it means something slightly different. And so different rabbis had different sets of interpretations about how they lived out and understood and interpreted the scriptures. Now, a rabbi's set of interpretations was called that rabbi's yoke. So when you went and applied to a rabbi to become one of that rabbi's disciples, what you wanted to do is you wanted to take that rabbi's yoke upon you so that you could learn to know what the rabbi knows, in order to do what the rabbi does, in order to be like the rabbi. So you'd go to a rabbi and you'd say, Rabbi, I want to become one of your disciples. The rabbi would then grill you. The rabbi would ask you questions about Torah, questions about the prophets, questions about the oral tradition, because the rabbi wants to know, can this kid sit in front of me? Can this kid do what I do? Can this kid spread my yoke? Does this kid have what it takes? So the rabbi would fire off all these questions and grill the kid. And if the rabbi thought this kid's good, this kid loves God, loves Torah, but this kid isn't the best of the best of the best, the rabbi might say to the kid, you know, you obviously love God and you obviously know the Torah, but you don't have what it takes to become one of my disciples. And so the rabbi might say something like, go and continue learning your family trade, continue plying your family trade. But if the rabbi thinks this kid has got it, I think this kid could do what I do, the rabbi would say to the kid, come, follow me. And so you would leave as this, 14, 15 year old kid, you would leave your family, your friends, your synagogue, your village, and you would devote your entire life to being like your rabbi learning to do what your rabbi does. This is what it means to be a disciple. So, a rabbi comes to town, a powerful rabbi, and he's got like his little pack of disciples with him, and they're doing everything they can to keep up with him because they've devoted their lives to doing what their rabbi does. So if you're a disciple, by the end of the day with your rabbi traveling on these hot, dusty, dirty roads, you've got whatever your rabbi stepped in just caked all over the front of you. And so this saying developed among the wise men and the sages that you would say to a disciple, you'd say, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. This is a scene that everybody had seen this. They knew exactly what it meant to be covered in the dust of your rabbi. Now, all of this, to me, has huge implications for Jesus and how we understand Jesus, because most rabbis would begin their teaching around the age of 30. And in the Bible, around the age of 30, we have Jesus walking down the shore along the Sea of Galilee, and he comes across Peter and Andrew, and they're fishermen, and Jesus says to them, come, follow me. Well, if they're fishermen, and Jesus calls them to be his disciples, then they're not following another rabbi. And if they're not following another rabbi, they're not the best of the best. They didn't make the cut. And the text continues. It says that at once they dropped their nets and followed him, which I've always thought is a bit strange. I mean, it's odd, isn't it? That they just drop them and go. And I don't, some of those Christian movies don't help, do they? I mean, it's like Jesus comes down the beach and he's in this white bathrobe and he has this light blue beauty pageant sash on, you know, and his hair is blow dried and he's Swedish and he calls the disciples and they're kind of these robots. They kind of come around and go after him. If you understand it, like in its original context, it starts to make perfect sense. I mean, rabbis were the most honored, respected, revered people anywhere. I mean, the best of the best of the best are the only ones who got to be rabbis. And this rabbi comes down the beach and says to you, come follow me. Well, what's he really saying? What he's really saying is, I think you could do what I do. I mean, he's saying you can be like me. Of course you drop your nets and follow him. And then the text even continues. It says that he comes across James and John and they're fishing with their father Zebedee. Now, if they're fishing with their father, what are they? They're apprentices. They're learning the family business. And if he calls them to be his disciples, and they're not the disciples of some other rabbi. So James and John, they're not good enough. They didn't make the cut either. They aren't the best of the best. And how old are they? 15? 16? I mean, 20? I mean, these are not old men. They're young. I mean, Jesus chooses them because his movement is for everybody. I mean, it's for rich and for poor and for women and men and educated and uneducated. I mean, actually, what's one of the things they say about them later on? One of the things they say about them later on is, these guys are like unschooled fishermen. I mean, it's for the peasants and the scholars. It's like a movement of anybody's, and he calls them the JV, the B team, the not good enoughs. He calls them to be his disciples, and they change the course of human history. So back to the walking on water thing. I mean, you have this boat full of anybodies, and the water's choppy, and the wind's blowing, and they're terrified because this Jesus comes across the water to them, and they think he's a ghost. And then Peter says, well, if it's you, then tell me to come to you. Now, why is this Peter's first response? Why is Peter's first reaction, if it's you, then tell me to come to you? Because he's a disciple. I mean, he's oriented his whole life, devoted his whole life to doing what he sees his rabbi doing, learning to be like his rabbi. So he sees his rabbi walking on water, and what's the first thing he wants to do? I want to walk on water too. I want to be like my rabbi. And so Peter gets out of the boat, and he starts walking on the water, but he starts to sink, and he yells out, Jesus, save me. And the text reads that Jesus immediately caught him and said, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Now, I always assumed that Peter doubts Jesus, but Jesus isn't sinking. Who does Peter doubt? He doubts himself. He loses faith in himself that he can actually be like his rabbi. I mean, Jesus wouldn't have called him if he didn't think he could be like him. Jesus even reminds his disciples of this at one point. He says to them, wait, you didn't choose me, I chose you. The rabbi doesn't choose you unless the rabbi thinks that you can do what he does, that you can be like him. I mean, all my life I've heard people talk about believing in God. But God believes in us, in you. In me. I mean, faith in Jesus is important, but what about Jesus' faith in us? I mean, he must have faith in us because he leaves it all in the hands of these disciples. And what's the last thing Jesus says to them? He says to them, "Now you go and make more disciples." He leaves it all in the hands of these anybodies, and they do it. I mean, what if we can actually be the kinds of people that God created us to be? What if he actually believes that? I mean, what if he actually believes that we can be the kind of people who live like Jesus lived? And the kinds of people who take action because we're aware of all of these endless opportunities around us all the time for good, for beauty, for truth. I mean, Jesus has faith that you can follow him and you can be like him. He believes it. God, but may you come to see that God believes in you. May you have faith in Jesus, but may you come to see that Jesus has faith that you can be like him, a person of love and compassion and truth, a person of forgiveness and peace and grace and joy and hope, and may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, Jesus.